Welcome to Whispering Loudly, the Workshop Whisperer podcast, as featured by Apple. Thanks to Platinum sponsor, Podium, Titanium sponsor, Mechanic Desk, and Gold sponsor, Safety Stop, with Rachel Sheldrick, the number one automotive business coach in the aftermarket.
Betty Klemenko broke the mold when she entered the Supercars Championship in 2013. All tattoos, black boots and bleached hair, and her down-to-earth go-get-em attitude made her an instant hit. The popular motorsport matriarch has since set a new standard for accessibility, providing glimpses of behind-the-scenes action to loyal fans. A shake-up at the beginning of 2016 saw Betty surrounded by new drivers, race cars, and many new faces when she moved her team from Queensland to Victoria. Fast forward 18 months and her team of David Reynolds and Luke Yulden not only conquered the mountain, but every powerhouse garage further up pit lane. Bathurst 2017 is a large chapter in Betty's incredible life story. And in 2019, the loyalty that Betty has shown to her driver, David Reynolds, resulted in another awesome chapter. David created history by signing a 10-year agreement, unheralded in supercars and a rarity in sport. That agreement will see David's tenure extended to 14 years. Betty has always had a long-term plan for her team, and she vows she won't give up on taking the fight to the bigger teams. Welcome to the Workshop Whisperer podcast, Betty Klemenko.
For those who might have been living under a rock since 2013, can you let me know a little bit about your team?
Well, we started off at the very, very bottom end of motorsport in the F3s, and we worked our way up until we reached the GT level, which is overseas and here is actually now getting a good reputation. And we won the championship, we won the 12-hour endurance race at Bathurst with our Mercs, and basically it was, I'm not racing enough. There's only 6 rounds every year. I want to race more. How do I do that? Only way to do it is to go into V8 supercars. And it was, at that time, you had to bring in a new manufacturer. So we took in the HSV, not allowed to call it Mercedes, Mercedes on the road. So we went into the Mercs. The hard thing about that was we had to make our own engine, and we did it in 109 days, which is unheard of, and we got the cars out for that season. Put in a lot of money in there, put a lot of money into the Mercs and into those couple of years, and then went, I can't do this anymore in the sense of the amount that it was costing. So yeah. I just went, yeah, let's just go to Holden. Yeah. It seems to suit everybody else, so let's go to Holden. That's what we did. And since then, it's just everything seems to have clicked into place.
What made you want to get into motorsport in the first place?
In motorsport now for close to 23 years. I've always loved motorsport, but I was a property developer. I worked with my father. It was like a planned family thing, you know, you just can't get out of family, you know, business. And then my father passed away, and I just went, I've been working here for so long that I looked at my sister, who's 19 years younger than me, and I just pointed my finger at her and her husband and went, it's your turn. I'm still on the board. I still am the vice chairman, but I don't spend any time, well, as much time in the office as I used to. And I spend more time doing motorsport, and we're just about to have our 6th grandchild. So, and I'm a hopeless grandmother. So I think I have to change all that.
In 2018, The Age said that you were the unlikely heiress revving up motorsport. Can you tell us why they might call you the unlikely heiress?
Well, I live in Sydney in the eastern suburbs, and everyone around me drives Mercedes, and, you know, they go to Bridge and they go shopping, and this is all pre-COVID. Mm-hmm. And I didn't do that. I've got tattoos everywhere. I look more goth than anything else. I drive a Holden. I have other cars as well, but we have 2 Holdens now. And my mind never went along that path. My mind wasn't in the gutter per se, but I love being with people, like being with people who matter to me, and the people who matter to me are the everyday people that work very hard for a living, especially in motorsport. And I always had something to talk to them about. You know, I wasn't I didn't have to sit there looking at them and saying to myself, think pink, you know, say something girly. You know, I could be myself, and that's what I've always loved to do, is to just to be myself.
Erebus Motorsport is known as a great team with a good culture and loyalty amongst it. For our audience of auto repair shop owners globally listening to this, wanting to create a great culture, what tips would you have for them about how you've achieved it?
Very good question. Loyalty, I think, starts at the top of the tree, and it's your loyalty that you show to your employees, to your drivers, that comes back in spades to you. I treat my staff like I would treat a friend, but they do know that there is a line. You know, I might go with them and have a beer, but then after two beers, I walk away so they don't have to, you know, they can go and get pizzled without the boss. It's knowing how to balance, to make the balance, and where the line is. You've got to know where your line is. My line may be different to someone else's. You know, my line is, you know, 12 vodkas and I go home, but someone else might be 2 vodkas and they go home. You just have to know where your line is.
So what I'm hearing is there needs to be boundaries that you respect as the owner so that they have respect for them as well, that you care by having great conversations with them and learning about what's important to them and really allowing them to have fun in your organisation, but also allowing them to go off and have fun in their personal life.
No, we have at track, we will be very professional when it comes to racing. But the minute the race is over, on come the hillbilly music and the pigs and, I don't know, every other type of music you can think of, and it goes on loud. We have a certain culture in our team, and, you know, you don't want me singing because I sound like a frog, but I do it anyway. And then I know when, you know, I know that these guys are giving me their everything that they have. They just did 109 days outside of their home stage, not seeing their families. Any one of them could have walked away at any time in those 109 days, but they didn't. They stayed with the team, and that says a lot to me.
So for our shop owners out there who feel like throwing in the towel, there would have been times where you felt that way, especially when you were hemorrhaging money with Mercedes. When you were running those, you would have felt like throwing in the towel, I'm sure. What would you say to our listeners that feel like throwing in the towel? What's your advice to them?
The CEO of my company, Barry Ryan, who's getting a very bad rap at the moment, don't believe a word that's being said about him. And this is what happens when you allow yourself to have a series made about it. They pick villains and they pick Barry. But Barry is one of the most kind-hearted men that you will ever find. Anyway, he said to me, he was on television. They were talking about me and he just said, how many buses do you want her to climb out from under? Because it was just one thing after another after another. And I had just got to the last bus that had just knocked me over. And I thought, why do I do this when I could just stay at home and not do this? There's something inside you that says, get up, you fat little turd, and get up and start doing it again. And then it doesn't matter what they throw at you. You get up. Though, you know, as long as I can stand up, I can get up. And sometimes it's not even just me standing up, people standing up for me. And that makes me get up. You know, the motorsport's a very hard game. You can have things slung at you. You know, there's enough crap being thrown at you all the time. And I'm a woman, the only woman who owns a team, who started a team. You've got to work twice as hard. And I don't care what anyone says. I have never had a problem with them. I've never had a problem with the boys' club. But I still have to prove myself twice as much just to do it. But I just get up. You just get up and you know that the sun's going to come up tomorrow. Those are the things that pull you along, because it's not worth giving up. Because you know that tomorrow the only way is up and you're going to solve it. I have a saying that I say in my head, just do what you effing have to do. And that's when I'm really down, I just go, get your big ass off the ground and just do what you effing have to do. That just pushes me along.
Finally, Betty, my clients would have my guts for garters if I didn't ask you what it felt like to win Bathurst and be crowned the Queen of the Mountain.
Very good question, because when it happened, I couldn't talk. I literally didn't think it was going to happen.
Right.
And as Dave was doing his last lap, as he was coming down in front of the hotel, then he's coming into the last corner, I had to have my back turned to the track and I was looking at the big screen because I just didn't want to jinx it. He still had one corner left and I've never felt like this. My heart was in my mouth. I just got this whole, oh my God, we are going to win this thing. And he came round the last corner. He goes through and I hear the commentators say, you've won, you know, Erebus, Dave Reynolds has won Bathurst. And I'm like, nah, don't be stupid. That's my husband's grabbing me and kissing me and hugging me. They put a microphone. I went, I can't talk. Go away. And I was rude. And I'm not really rude, but I just couldn't talk. And then when I did talk, I said the most stupid thing. Oh, I wonder if my children are watching this. That was out of everything I could say in my whole life, I just wanted to know if my children were watching. So my poor children each got like 1,000 phone calls. Did you see your mother just watch Bathurst? Blah, blah, blah. For me, it was a bucket list thing. This was Bathurst was something that was in the future. This was not for my second year as a holding car. This was something that was in the future, and I was looking forward to it. And I spent the day talking and doing all this, you know, doing everything you do in Bathurst. Because after, you know, being up early in the morning, all you want to go do is find a little hole to have a nana nap. And I don't think it even hit me when we were leaving the track, because we live in Sydney, so we drove back to Sydney. And I got home and I got in the bathtub. I stood up in the bath and I started kicking all the water and going, I effing won Bathurst. This is at 2 a.m. And since then it was just like, yeah, you did, but you deserved it. And that to me, yeah, that is, if you deserve something and you get it, that is the best way to get it.
That's an amazing story, and I know it's not luck. I've read so much about you, and I've actually seen you speak live in Newcastle. Lovely to speak to you. We wish you all the best for the year ahead, and we can't wait to, and we look forward to seeing your team up on the winner's dais again, and we can't wait to hear more stories about you in the media.
Oh, God, I'm trying to take a step back. You know, because I want to move to the country. I love animals as well. But I love cars. So I'm building a huge garage there.
Oh, very nice. I think lots of us have thought about moving to the country after being locked in the city with COVID.
I think it's worse because both of my sons are building houses next door to me in Sydney. I'm going to have all the grandchildren. And it's like, okay. Yeah. I don't babysit. I do motorsport.
All right, Betty, and thanks for being a dream to interview, and thanks to your assistant for helping us organise.
Oh, look, without Sonia, I'd be nowhere. I don't even know how to turn a computer on. I know how to buy things, though.
Bye. Thanks for listening to Whispering Loudly, the Workshop Whisperer podcast, as featured by Apple. Thanks to Platinum sponsor Podium, Titanium sponsor Mechanic Desk, and Gold sponsor Safety Stop with Rachel Sheldrick, the number one automotive business coach in the aftermarket.